If the devil can be defeated there, he can be defeated in people's lives on earth. How does God do this? Well, as one preacher says, the book of Job shows that at the heart of all life, there is undeserved suffering that makes undeserved blessing possible. Because a blameless man suffered, unrighteous people can be rescued from the devil and know mercy and grace. And ultimately, God does this through Jesus' suffering. Job is showing the way that Jesus would suffer and bring life from his death. So he does it ultimately through Jesus, but he also does it through the life of every Christian, through Job. But in Ephesians 3:10, it says God's intent was that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known in the heavens to all the principalities and powers. So that includes us as well. This goes against everything the devil believes. He believes life is found in self-interest, living for ourselves, putting ourselves first, and getting health and wealth and power above everything else. So Jesus' suffering is a real challenge to him, as is Job's, as is yours, as you trust in Jesus. And he says so. He says, oh, we'll only serve Jesus while he keeps giving us stuff or while he keeps protecting our health. But Jesus shows that just simply isn't true. Instead of cursing God like everyone wants him to and thinks he's going to, Job blesses God just as Jesus does in his suffering. He loses everything, but he still has hope because Jesus, his Redeemer, lives. And a massive chunk of the book is then taken up with Job's friends going backwards and forwards between them and Job. And really what Jesus is saying is, if you take him out of the book, then you have to try and understand life and suffering and everything in the dark. His friends think that suffering is caused by our sin, by our pride, by our selfishness. And if only we could become more spiritual or more religious, we'd all be free from suffering. They say, Job, you must have done something wrong. It must be your fault. But this is a very poor and dark understanding of how life works. Out of this storm of unbelief and human wisdom, Jesus speaks so clearly and shows he's Lord of everything. Because of his suffering, he has disarmed the devil and all his powers and is able to save. The book of Job shows us that after the devil has done his worst, we are still safe in Jesus' arms, not because we're better than anyone else, not because we are more righteous, but simply because of his power to hold on to us and defeat the devil's plans by his blood. And he rescues Job's friends from their sin and they're saved. What an amazing ending. Jesus has shown the devil up. His ways are pointless and they lead to death. Jesus' ways are wise and they lead to life. So know this month as you read, in your suffering, if you trust in Jesus, there is meaning to every single bit. God is working it all for your good and you are safe in the arms of Jesus forever. An old hymn says this, I know that my Redeemer lives. What comfort this sweet sentence gives. He lives who once was dead. He lives, my ever-living head. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, like Job's friends and the devil, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. And after hearing what Jesus has done for us, this is a good place to start, isn't it? To bless him, whether it's our first day here, or we're somewhere in the middle, or our last day, we've always got 10,000 reasons to bless him for what he's doing for us. So let's stand and sing.
everyone. While Matt and Nathaniel are putting the instruments away, if you have your Bibles, would you like to turn to the book of Job? We're in chapter 1, verses 6 to 11, but then we're going to chapter 41, verses 1 to 9. So starting in chapter 1, verses 6 to 11. One day, the angels came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came with them. The Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" Satan answered the Lord, "From roaming throughout the earth, going to and fro on it." Then the Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one on earth like him. He is blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil." "Does Job fear God for nothing?" Satan replied. "Have you not put a hedge around him and his household and everything he has? You have blessed the work of his hands so that his flocks and herds are spread throughout the land. But now stretch out your hand and strike everything he has, and he will surely curse you to your face." And then turn into chapter 41, verses 1 to 9. "Can you pull in Leviathan with a fish hook or tie down its tongue with a rope?
Cool. Brilliant. Doing a good job, by the way. It's hard when everything goes wrong. And Joanna as well, thank you. Let's pray, isn't it? Father, we just thank you again for your word. And maybe the devil was embarrassed and he didn't want us to hear it. So he tried turning the mic off, I don't know. But Lord, we pray that, as you always do, you would overrule and speak to us about your victory and power, as you do in Job. And we pray the whole world might see. They don't need to live in darkness or lies or be confused anymore. There is light and life in the Lord Jesus Christ, and he has risen from the dead, and he has disarmed all the powers of evil. Lord, we pray that we might, after listening to Job this evening, not go away depressed, Lord, but go away with confidence, Lord Jesus, knowing that nothing can snatch us out of your hands. For your glory's sake we ask. Amen. Yeah, sorry about, I don't know what happened with the overview video. It was like an old Bruce Lee film, wasn't it? My lips were moving and my voice was like 3 seconds out. So sorry if that freaked you out a little bit, but you can see this is live now. So we're sort of, we're going to do a little bit of an overview of Job tonight, just to help give like some keys, if you want some tools, as you're reading it this month, because a huge chunk of it is Job and his friends on earth having loads of conversations about pain, suffering, guilt, who's to blame. But that's That's life on earth, isn't it? That's what you hear in the pub, in the workplace, isn't it? All those sorts of stuff, trying to understand what on earth literally is going on. And all sorts of stuff said and accusations, isn't it? But before we do that, and I think that's why Job starts with that, Jesus pulls back the curtains so we can get a glimpse into heaven itself. And I think that's a massive relief because, yeah, our lives are lived here on earth, but if we just live like that's everything, none of it makes any sense. Ecclesiastes is famous for that in the Bible, isn't it? Life under the sun. Under the sun, there's nothing new. Under the sun, everything's the same. Under the sun, there's no hope. Under the sun, there's no help. But what Jesus is saying is, there is something above the sun. There is something beyond the sun. We live life under it, but he lives life looking over it all in heaven. And I think that's why it starts there. And if we're going to understand our lives here on earth, we've got to start in heaven. We've got to look there. And that's exactly what the Bible says all the time, isn't it? Let us fix our eyes on Jesus. Where is he? In heaven. Let us fix our eyes not on what is seen, because that's temporary, all the suffering and pain. Let us fix our eyes on what is unseen. Who's that? Jesus, isn't it? Jesus. So that's what we're going to be doing this evening. And as we look into heaven and see what Jesus is doing, our lives here on earth will make a lot more sense. And in the end, we'll see, actually, in chapter 41, Jesus has all the power. So the first thing is from chapter 1 there. And it's really clear. I think really, really clear message there, isn't it? God is the one with the ultimate power. I know you hear it loads in church and it's cliched and whatever else, isn't it? But the devil has to ask for permission in everything he does. I know you're all thinking, well, why does God give it? Why does he do it? Because then all this stuff happens to me. Well, you got to, again, you got to sort of look beyond you to see it. But God created everyone, everything, every power, whether it's visible or invisible, angels, demons, stars, stuff out there we haven't even seen. And he's given everything and everyone a calling, which is what we've been doing in the morning, isn't it? Including the devil. He obviously didn't create him evil. He created him. If you read in Ezekiel again, he's an incredibly beautiful being. So much so it went to his head and he got proud. We did that this morning, isn't it? And he sinned. He turned against God. But what is God's intention? I think it's not the devil. Like I mentioned in the video, is it, the devil doesn't make the first move here, which is really fascinating, isn't it? Really interesting. God is the one who says, have you considered my servant Job? Maybe Job got to heaven and read Job then. He's like, thanks, Lord. Why did you do that? But it's God who says, isn't it? And I think it's all to do with that calling because of the question that Jesus asks Satan, asks the devil. He says, where have you come from? Now, it's not because Jesus doesn't know. Don't think it's like, oh, you disappeared out of my sight for a little bit. You were up to some mischievous plan and I couldn't figure out what it was. It's not that. Where have you been? It's more like this. What have you been doing? He wants to expose the devil's way of life in front of all the powers of heaven. And he's written Job so you can see it and hear about it. So this question is deeper than just where you've been today. It's what are you living for? What have you been doing with all your time, with all your power, with the calling I've given you? What an answer, isn't it? It's a rubbish answer. Oh, going here and there. Wandering about. But that's exactly what happens when you refuse to join in Jesus' great calling, isn't it? Of loving him and serving our neighbor, loving our neighbor. Is you've got nothing to do apart from to cause mischief in one sense, isn't it? And that's what he's doing.
He's got an empty life. So what is God doing here? Well, Ephesians 3:10, I know I said it on the video, but let me just read it again. His intent, that's God. God's intent was that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms. Through Job, who's going to be a weak, suffering, struggling, sometimes under it, Christian, God is going to show off his incredible power and wisdom. That's his intent in all this. And show how wrong and guilty the devil is, and show how everyone who follows him is trapped in darkness and lies, and that how Jesus can rescue. But God is calling out the devil here to expose him. That's what I believe is going on. And God, when God starts working and speaking, that's when he starts accusing. And that's one of his titles in the Bible, the accuser, if you've got an old translation, of the brethren. You roll your R's, isn't it, extra in Wales? The accuser of the brethren. Basically, it means the one who shouts in your face, the one who accuses the church. But it's God who brings it up, isn't it? It's only when God starts speaking and working and showing off his wisdom through Job, see how he's upright and blameless, no one like him, then he starts accusing. He only follows you because you protect him. He won't carry on loving you if you touch his health. But twice we're told that Job did not sin in all of this. So first of all, he loses his kids, his wealth, nearly everything, but he still has his health. He didn't sin, and then he lost his health, and he still didn't sin in all of that. He says that amazing line, isn't it? The Lord gives, the Lord also takes away. Blessed, like we've just sung, blessed be the name of the Lord. He still loves Jesus. He still trusts in Jesus. This isn't the only time in the Bible it happens. It happens to Joshua the high priest, isn't it? Is it Zechariah or Zephaniah? Zechariah, I always get the two muddled up, Zechariah. And he comes, doesn't he, wearing filthy clothes, and the devil's there accusing him in front of Jesus. And Jesus says, get those clothes off of him. And he puts pure white clothes. So it's like saying he's clean. You got nothing more to say. So the devil is the great accuser, but Jesus is the greater justifier. That's the first point. That's all the devil can do. He can accuse, he can lie, but Jesus can make it all right. He is the greater justifier. Do you remember Edmund in Narnia? Have anyone ever seen the films or read the books? Remember Edmund in Narnia? He loves a bit of Turkish delight, doesn't he? I love Turkish delight. I don't know if I'd follow a witch for it, but there he didn't know, did he? But there we are. So he gets like trapped by this evil witch, doesn't he, who's trying to show how lovely and kind she is. She's lying through her teeth, of course, isn't she? But he follows her, and he doesn't realize what he's doing. It's only later on, it all opens up, isn't it? And he becomes really ashamed because he's a traitor. He's betrayed Aslan. He's betrayed his brothers and sisters, and he gets in terrible trouble. And Lucy, the little sister, begs Aslan, who represents Jesus, this great big lion, is there any way that Edmund can be saved? And Aslan shows, isn't he? He dies for Edmund and rises again. So he's like a picture of Jesus. He allows himself to be taken to that stone table, and he smashes the power of it, representing the law, and he rises again. But later on, the witch comes to challenge them, and she says this: "You have a traitor there, Aslan," said the witch. Of course, everyone present knew that she meant Edmund. But Edmund had got past thinking about himself after all he'd been through and after the talk he'd had that morning. He just went on looking at Aslan. It didn't seem to matter what the witch said. What an amazing change, isn't it? He knew he was guilty. He knew he was a traitor. And yet this witch who was right in what she was saying in one way, isn't it? You have a traitor. He was guilty. And yet her words could just bounce off. Why? Because he'd seen what Aslan had done for him and he just kept his eyes on him. That's where my hope is. He stopped thinking about himself. How many times does the devil come and try and accuse us? And let's be honest, isn't it? It's not always quite like Job, is it? Sometimes we have done what he accuses us of. We are guilty. We are traitors. We do betray Jesus, don't we? We do sin against him. We let him down. And he comes and reminds us again and again. What do? We fix our eyes not on ourselves, but on Jesus, because Jesus is the one who justifies. Listen to this. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified freely by his grace, by his undeserved kindness, through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. If you're a Christian, some of what he says to you might be true. You might be guilty for all of what he says to you. And you know his voice, isn't it? When it comes to you and he says all sorts of things. He accuses you, puts you down, says you're beyond hope, you failed too much, you can't know forgiveness now, after he's tempted you and said that's not what will happen. So he's lied to your face and then he comes and kicks you after you've sinned and down. He doesn't offer you any hope. Jesus is the one who has paid for all your sins. Edmund was a traitor, but Aslan had suffered in his place. We are sinners, but if you've trusted in Jesus, none of it can stick to you anymore because it all stuck to him, if you like, on the cross. Isn't that amazing, isn't it? He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree. What an amazing thing, isn't it? And the devil can say what he likes. And maybe 99% of it is true. But there's something else that's true. Like Aslan says, isn't it? There's a deeper magic, isn't it? There's something deeper than that. It could be all 100% true. I deserve hell. I deserve God's anger. I'm a traitor. I've betrayed him. I've denied him like Peter. I've believed all these lies. I've done all this. But it's also true that Jesus has died in my place for my sins to justify me. And it says in Romans, who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? Not Satan. Christ Jesus. Only he has the power to say guilty or innocent. It's the words from his mouth you need to be concerned with, if you like. My dear children, 1 John, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. That's your defense, isn't it, against his accusations? I sin, he doesn't. He took my sin to make it as if I've never sinned. He's justified me. He's the righteous one. And Romans goes on, isn't it? Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. The devil will accuse and he will never stop. But you should know Jesus is a greater justifier and he will never stop. Go over to chapter 4. And we're just going to look at a little bit of the introduction. So that's what's going on in the heavenly realms, if you like, in heaven. There's this big sort of showdown that Jesus can only win. And he does it by dying for you and rising for you to justify you. Back down to earth now. Because we're not always aware of that, are we? Well, I think none of us are ever really aware of that, are we? What's going on in heaven from one second to the next? But this next chunk starts with Job's friends coming to try and help him, to comfort him. For a while, they sit there in silence, don't they? They don't know what to say. Maybe that's more of a comfort than their words. But then they start to speak. So, like, they take their turns in speaking, and Job takes his turn in answering. And what you need to know is Job, you'll keep coming across, he holds on to his righteousness that he's done no wrong. And they keep accusing him and saying, you must have done something wrong. So we're going to zoom in on this through a few Sunday nights, I think, me and Brian, because we realize we always go for the first and the last bit, so we never really dig into what Job's friends believe and what he sort of says to them. So we're going to try and cover it. But just to get us started, so you don't get confused about Job's friends, listen to this. Chapter 4, verse 12-17. This is what Job's friend says. This is where he is speaking into Job's life from. A word was secretly brought to me. My ears caught a whisper of it. Amid disquieting dreams in the night, when deep sleep falls on men, fear and trembling seized me and made all my bones shake. A spirit glided past my face, and the hair on my body stood on end. It stopped, but I could not tell what it was. A form stood before my eyes, and I heard a hushed voice. Can a mortal be more righteous than God? Can a man be more pure than his maker? I don't know about you, but when the hairs stand up on the back of my neck, that means danger, doesn't it? That is like a frightening, life-threatening thing, isn't it? When the hairs on your neck stand up, isn't it? You're like, oh, something grips you, doesn't it? Does that sound like a message from Jesus? A spirit glided past my face like a great big serpent. Didn't really make himself clear, talks in a whisper, and my hair stood up on the back of my neck. Uh-uh. Where's that from? So not only is the devil accusing Job in the heavenly places, but now, can you see what he's done? He's gliding. Oh, it's horrible, isn't it? You know, he's worming his way, squirming his way into his friends' minds, filling them with half-truths, stuff that sounds a bit believable. So when you read Job's friends, you will start to read, and me and Brian were discussing this, because we were like, that sounds right. And some of it you're like, oh, hang on a minute, do we sort of say in a sermon that's right, isn't it? That's what we should build our lives. Because some of it there, you think, that's quite a nice truth about Jesus there, that he never fails or something. But, of course, he has to tell enough truth to make it believable, doesn't he? That's his subtlety, isn't it? That's the way he glides past you and worms his way in, is almost by something that sounds right to you. And even though your hair might stand up on the back of your neck, how often have we been taken in by what he says? The devil is called the gliding serpent, isn't he? That Jesus is going to crush. And as you suffer in this world, he will surround you with lies. That's how you mean it. Oh, it's horrible, isn't it? So whenever you read Job's friends, at the end of their sentences, do that. Like a snake. Just to remind yourself. Because that's what's happening, isn't it? That's what's going on. And remember, isn't that exactly what he did to Jesus in the wilderness? Jesus was led there by the Spirit. What does the devil do? He quotes the Bible. He makes it sound right. Why should the Son of God go hungry? Why shouldn't he have a kingdom that looks awesome and impressive? Why shouldn't he just be able to jump off the temple and be caught by loads of angels? You can see his mindset doesn't work the same as Jesus, does it? It's all messed up. But that's how Jesus works, isn't it? I'll go hungry and I will suffer to save all these people. I will have a kingdom that you can't see right now because one day God the Father is going to give me everything. I don't need to see all the angels getting ready to catch me and jump off. I trust him. Trust his word. And what does Jesus do? So the devil comes in with Bible quotes, but they're all twisted, aren't they, to suit his own ends. But they do sound half believable. What does Jesus do? He answers him with the truth. So the devil is the great liar. Jesus says that's his native language, is lies. But Jesus is the truth. And you've definitely heard tonight the devil sliding past your face and trying to get into your head, because that's what he loves to do, isn't it? Promising pleasure. And he'll use all sorts of tactics. I think one of the Puritans, Brian will correct me if I'm wrong, I can't remember who it was, but wrote Precious Remedies Against Satan's Devices. It was Thomas Brooks or Thomas Watson. You can read it, but man alive, it's like full of hundreds of ways the devil tries. So you know, don't you? Like, when you're feeling confident, he'll knock it. When you're feeling rubbish, he'll make you feel more rubbish. Then he'll get you to indulge in something and make you feel more rubbish for it, isn't it? He's just horrible. And yet he'll keep sliding past, trying to keep you under his control, blinding you and deafening you to Jesus' voice and light. What do we need to do then? Or if it helps, he'll tell you lies about yourself. You're beyond saving, or you're really good. You see how he works? Pride or just rubbishness, condemnation. He'll tell you lies about others. They're only doing that because they don't really like you. Try and do that in church all the time, doesn't he? He tries to stir us up against each other. He will try and tell you lies about God. But all he is like an ugly... Have you seen an anglerfish in the sea? You seen those things? In the dark, where the sun doesn't get to, they look really beautiful, don't they? You just see this glowing warm light in the dark water. Have you ever seen it? And the little helpless fishy, isn't it? It's like, oh, look, a light. Or if you've seen the film Bug's Life, isn't it? Like a moth to the light, and his friend says, don't fly into the light. And he's like, I can't help it, it's so beautiful. That's like the little fishy. Look at this glowing light. It pulls him in. Pulls him in. And he gets closer and closer, and he thinks he's going to get warm, and he thinks he's going to be in the light, and he's going to understand everything and see everything. And what happens? Just as he gets there, this huge set of jaws with sharp teeth just... And now he's in the darkness within the darkness. That's all the devil does. Holds out his false little light and then bites, gnashes you in. So what do we do? Well, Job says, even now my witness is in heaven. He preaches the truth to himself. My advocate is on high. My intercessor is my friend. As my eyes pour out tears to God, on behalf of a man, he pleads with God as a man pleads for his friend. He preaches the truth. He's like, this is what I feel. This is what I'm suffering. And if you read some of the stuff he says, he's really being pushed down, isn't he, by his friends, by the devil's really trying to do everything, coil around him and trying to suffocate the life out of him. And he says some stuff, doesn't he? He's really going through it. It's not he's sort of floating through it. He's wrestling. He's crying in anguish. He's crying for his children. He's like, his wife is going for him as well. It's all this stuff. But he says, even now, in the middle of that, I know the truth. Even now, Jesus is pleading for me in heaven, my friend, the one who pleads for me, is there, my intercessor. And what does he say in chapter 19? I know. I can't see it. Maybe I can't feel it. maybe I can't hear it, but I know this. I know that my Redeemer lives. The one who's paid for my sin, he's alive. And that in the end, he will stand on the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh, I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes. I and not another. How my heart yearns within me. He cries out these amazing truths that he knows, he believes. The devil is the great liar, but Jesus is the greater truth. And that's what he holds on to, isn't it? The one who's paid for me is alive. He's going to die, but he's alive. And he is the one who will stand on earth and defeat the devil's power. And then the bit that Joanna read in chapter 41, lastly, very quickly, Jesus is questioning Job now, and he says, can you pull in the Leviathan? The Leviathan is a massive serpent, so it's the devil again. Can you pull him in with a fish hook? Tie his tongue down with a rope. Have you ever tried to shut him up? It doesn't work, does it? When you try. You can't pull him away from his plan, can you, with your strength? You can't make him beg for mercy. You can't make him speak to you gently. You can't get him to make an agreement to leave you alone or to serve you instead of destroy you. You can't make a pet. He's this huge dragon. Can you kill him? You can't kill him. If you try and touch him, you'll remember it forever. Even the sight of him is overpowering. He's too much for us, is what Jesus is saying. But Jesus is the one who has him under his foot like that. It's a promise in Genesis, isn't it, to the devil. You will bite his heel, isn't it? He will bite Jesus, but Jesus will crush his head. And that's exactly where he's got him now, under his foot. He's been defeated. He is too much for us, and we keep getting bewitched, if you like, enchanted by what he says, isn't it? But Jesus comes on the scene, he's like, you can't tame him, you can't make him a pet, you can't get him to agree to serve you rather than destroy you. He stirs up the whole world by thrashing his tail. But he says, I can and I will, watch this. And he just saves Job's friends like that. Amazing, isn't it? After all they've said and done, when Job prays and the gospel is preached and they see the blood of the sacrifice, they're forgiven and they're saved. Out of nowhere, Jesus rescues these guys who've been swallowed, slithering by this slithering serpent. He saves them, brings them into the light. He says, that's my power. And he's done it for you if you've trusted in him, hasn't he? If you don't know him yet as your Savior, trust Jesus tonight. Call on Jesus. He's the only one who can shine that light into the dark. He's the only one who can rescue from those self-destructive lies. He's the only one who loves you more than his own life. And he's laid it down on a cross to save you. And what does it say in Revelation about the devil? They overcame him by what? Nuclear weapons, a huge army, by the power of Jesus' blood. There it is. One drop of his blood, and his power's done. And he took it and he applied it to your life, didn't he? Famous old hymn says, now let my soul arise and tread the tempter down. My captain leads me forth to conquest and a crown. A feeble saint shall win the day, though death and hell obstruct the way. Should all the hosts of death and powers of hell unknown put their most dreadful forms of rage and malice on, I shall be safe, for Christ displays superior power and guardian grace. What a song, but it's true. The devil's the accuser. Jesus is the greater justifier. The devil's a massive liar, but Jesus is the truth. The devil is a powerful enemy, but Jesus is the all-powerful Savior. Let's pray. Lord, please help us to lift our eyes to you, Lord Jesus, as we read Job this month. And as we live our lives here on earth, Lord, and we hear people trying to understand suffering and pain with their own eyes and with the devil's ideas, Lord, rescue us from it all. Lord, sometimes we get bogged down and we get tied up and we get hissed at and we start to believe all these things. Jesus, please, as the great justifier, the truth, and our all-powerful Savior, please rescue us. Lord, help us to see the truth in Jesus so clearly this month, we pray. Amen. We're going to sing from a video. I know we haven't done it for a little while, but we're going to do it tonight because we haven't practiced this one. But the words just go really well with what we've been looking at.
Oh, your name is my first defense. I know your name is my last amen. It carries me when I cannot stand. It reaches me when I reach the end. Jesus, your name, when the whole world shakes. Jesus, your name, I will ever praise. My battle cry, every night and day, I'll sing your name over everything. Yes, I'll sing your name. Fights for me and it won't relent. I cast my cares, every burden fall. For there's one name that can bear them all. Jesus, your name, when the whole world shakes. Jesus, your name, I will ever praise. My battle cry, every night and day, I'll sing your name over everything. Yes, I'll sing your name over everything. In every storm, of peace, the Lord of all, you are heaven's King. I sing your name till my last breath here, then I'll sing again with my first breath there. Jesus, your name, when the whole world shakes. Jesus, your name, I will ever praise. My battle cry, every night and day, I'll sing your name over everything. Yes, I'll sing your name over everything. I'll sing your name.